A very warm welcome to the plea expert webinar on sedition trial of Bal Gangadhar Tilak 1897 and 1908. It is our honor to have with us solicitor and historian Rajan Jaikar sir with us today. Sir, very warm welcome to the platform and thank you for once again accepting our invitation to speak.
My pleasure. It's a pleasure again speaking on the plea platform. I like history and therefore my topics will always be on some aspect of history as far as legal profession is concerned. I have selected this particular topic because I found that not only among lay people, but even among the lawyers, there was not much information available as regard the first two sedition trials of Lokmanya Tilak. The third one, of course, was ended in an acquittal, so we will not go into it. But these two trials are interconnected. So therefore, I thought that this will be a good subject to talk about and give knowledge about these matters to the not only the lay public, but the lawyers. These are the three trials, 1897, 1908, and 1916. Now, before we go into the trials, since the accused person or the affected person was Mr. Tilak, I have a little background of Tilak. And to begin with, he was born on 23rd July 1856 in a village called Chikhalgaon, Taluka Dapodi and District Ratnagiri. His father Gangadhar was a teacher in education department. Tilak's real name is Balwant, but famously known as Bal. Tilak had three elder sisters. He completed his school in 1872 from City School in Pune. Tilak had a terrific memory and used to solve mathematical problems without even using the slate. It will be surprising to note that while Tilak was still in school, he got married to Tapi Bai in 1871. Her name was subsequently changed to Satyabhama. Tilak's father died in August 1872 and was looked after by his uncle. In 1873, Tilak joined Deccan College in Pune. He did not take studies seriously, but was interested in arguing with his friends until he convinced them to his viewpoint. After doing the first year in Deccan College, Tilak came to Pune from Mumbai and joined Elphiston College in Bombay. Tilak was fond of mathematics and Sanskrit. He did his BA with mathematics in first class in 1876 and appeared for his maths MA exam, but unfortunately failed. At that point of time, it appears that Tilak decided to change his educational line. He went back to Pune, again joined Deccan College in 1876, and did his LLB from Deccan College in 1879. His favorite subject was Hindu law, and he had studied that subject very seriously. Tilak again tried his final luck with MA exams in mathematics, but again failed. And then he pursued his LLB seriously. And after getting LLB, he was conferred the degree at a convocation ceremony on 20th January 1880. After doing LLB, it would have been ordinarily for any person to join the practice by obtaining the sanad. Tilak did not do that and he did not want to practice as a wakil in the High Court. Instead, he opened a school called New English School, Budwarpet, at Pune on 1st January 1880. On the first day, there were 19 students who attended the school out of 150 students who were registered. In 3 months, the number became 500. A gentleman called Vaman Rao Apte, who was associated with the school, gave a very favorable opinion about the progress of the school before the Education Commission headed by Sir William Hunter. Vaman Rao Apte later on became principal of Ferguson College. To complete the chronology, Tilak died on 1st of August 1920 at Sardar Gruha. You'll see the illustration that he died in a sitting posture, which is very unusual. And for his funeral, thousands of people from Bombay gathered. Mahatma Gandhi was one of the pallbearers and Tilak was cremated at Chopati, where his statue stands today. Vaman Rao Apte invited Tilak and Agarkar, two of the scholars of that time, to join the two newspapers which was about to start, called Kesari and Maratha. He decided to start these newspapers with effect from 1st January 1881. Tilak started airing his views on Dharma Shastra and law, and the 7th edition of Kesari, he wrote about boycott of some of the government policies. With passage of time, in 1891, Tilak became editor of Kesari. Since about 1885, Tilak had started writing in Kesari on topics such as political, industrial, foreign affairs, he also started teaching as a, in order to have a side income of first and second year students of law till arrival of plague in Pune when the classes were stopped. In November 1896, there were editorials where Tilak heavily criticized the government in respect of handling of famine as well as Hindu-Muslim riots. And for a period of 4 to 5 months, there was very heavy criticism of government steps. In 1896, along with famine, plague epidemic also arrived and it spread all over Maharashtra. People started leaving Bombay and going to Gujarat. People started dying and offices and courts were closed. Tilak criticized the handling of the epidemic and passing of law, which gave military powers to the collector and the people who did not observe the law were punished severely. From quarantine to burning houses and forcibly shifting the patients was done with a heavy hand by the government. On 17 February 1886, Mr. Rand, the chief plague officer who has attended a function at the governor's residence in Pune, was returning home from a party at the governor's residence in midnight when a person shot Mr. Rand from the back. Now, this was apparently done because after Rand took charge as a chief plague officer, he had started inspecting houses for finding patients and use force for entering their houses and forcing ladies to come out. In the following car, Lieutenant Ihurst was traveling. Another person came and shot Ihurst in his head and he died on the spot. Rand, however, was rushed to the hospital and he died after 11 days. The government announced a price of 20,000 rupees for leading to the arrest of the murderers. Pune was surrounded by police who started pressurizing people to find out the murderers. With this background, Tilak wrote an article on 6th of July 1897 entitled, "Is Government's Head in the Right Place?" criticizing the government for presuming that the murderer was Brahmin and there was a very big conspiracy as part of the murder. It was followed by another article on 13 July 1897 titled, "To Rule Does Not Mean to Take Revenge." Now, these articles were not taken very easily by the government. Tilak started to collect all the complaints by starting a campaign where he appealed to the people to lodge complaints with Kesari for excesses done by the government during the plague pandemic. The idea was to collect this evidence of excesses and have it published by English newspaper in Bombay like Champion, etc. Government felt that those articles in Kesari criticizing the government and its officers for excesses during the plague epidemic were seditious. Government solicitor got the Kesari articles translated by Oriental translator Mirza Abbas Ali Beg and came to the conclusion that they actually were seditious. On 27 July 1897, a case was filed by solicitor Nicholson on behalf of the government against Tilak on the ground of sedition under section 124A of the Indian Penal Code before the Chief Presidency Magistrate, Mr. Slater, and arrest and search warrants were issued. Not only were issued against Tilak, but against Mr. Bal, the manager of Aryabhushan Printing Press, and the owner of the press, Hari Narayan Gokhale. The warrant was deliberately executed by arresting Tilak at about 10 p.m. to prevent Tilak from applying for the bail on the same day. On 28th of July 1897, barristers Russell Deshpande and Wakils Khare and Bodas applied for bail for Tilak, which was rejected by the magistrate. On 29 July 1897, appeal was made against the refusal of bail which was filed by Chivanlal Setalwad in the High Court, which was rejected by Justice Parson and Justice Ranade, that was the bench. The reason given was that the trial was to start before the police court in 2 days, and hence there was no reason to grant bail. On 2nd August 1897, the case was committed to the High Court Sessions. Now, I must tell you here that in those days, there was no Sessions Court. There were Chief Magistrates Court, Presidency Magistrates Court, and the High Court. So, all the matters which were beyond the competence of the Presidency Magistrate were committed or sent to the High Court for trial. So, that is how it is High Court Sessions. And on 4th of August, bail application came up before Justice Badruddin Tayabji. Now, Barrister Dawar, appearing for Tilak, was asked by Tayabji as to how much surety could his client give. Instead of consulting the client and quoting a small figure, he left it to the discretion of the court. The amounts were stiff, and with great difficulty, Tilak's friend managed to convince Vishnu Nene set Dwarkada Dharamsi to stand as security. The amounts were 25,000 each. That means two securities. So these two securities deposited their government promissory notes of 25,000 each, and Tilak was granted bail on 4th of August 1897. Now Tilak required funds to fight the case, and defense fund was established. Messrs. Bhai Shankar and Kanga solicitors agreed to work at a very small fee. The nature of the case was such that no British barrister was prepared to take up the Tilak's case. Surendranath Banerjee from Calcutta took lead in augmenting the defense fund, and sympathizers from Calcutta decided to appoint Barrister Pew and Barrister Garth, both British, to represent Tilak, who were actually practicing barristers in Calcutta High Court. Special officer on duty Brown contacted Mr. Tilak before 6 September, asking him to help find the murderers so that he can recommend to the government to go a little soft on him. Tilak promptly told him that he will not be a secret agent for the government and does not believe that the murderers have brought any bad name to Pune. It was the duty of the police to investigate and bring the murderers to book and punish them. He said that he would not give any help. So with this background, the trial started on 8th of September 1897 before Justice Strachey, and Barrister Pew and Barrister Garth, both from Calcutta, appeared for Tilak, and Advocate General Lang appeared for the government. Barrister Pew and Barrister Garth came to Bombay, and Junior Barrister Chowdhury, also from Calcutta, came with them as his assistant. However, permission to appear before the Bombay High Court was given only to Barrister Pew and was rejected to the others from Calcutta. Tilak barely got 2 weeks to prepare his defense with the Calcutta barristers. People from all parties had contributed to the defense fund. The jury for the trial consisted of 5 British, 1 Jew, 1 Parsi and 2 natives. Tilak was allowed to come out of the witness box while the matter was going on to sit behind his barrister Pew for giving instructions by Justice Strachey, before whom the trial was to start. Irony was that interpretation of Marathi articles on the basis of translations done by a Mohammedan Oriental translator was being done by 3 Englishmen, namely Justice Strachey, Advocate Lang and Barrister Pew. After cross-examination of the prosecution witnesses, the arguments were commenced by Advocate General, as Tilak did not produce any witnesses. Tilak's article justifying the murder of Afzal Khan and statements like "burn the robber who enters your house" was interpreted as applying to the British rulers by Advocate General. Barrister Pew argued that the murder of Afzal Khan has been discussed by so many different writers, but no such action was taken by the government against them. Pew interpreted section 124A and also the words disaffection and disloyalty and how they cannot be construed as sedition. Ultimately, the matter was finally heard. Juries returned the verdict 6 guilty and 3 not guilty. Accordingly, the judge, on the basis of the verdict of the jury, gave a sentence of 18 months of hard labor to Tilak on 13 September 1897. In consultation with Barrister Pew, Solicitor Bhai Shankar filed an application for leave to file appeal on 17 September 1897. On 24th September 1897, the appeal came up for hearing before full bench of Justice Farhan, Candy and Strachey. After the hearing, Barrister Russell for the appellant, that is Mr. Tilak, and Advocate General Lang for the respondent, Justice Farhan, speaking for the bench, said that there was no appealable point and leave to appeal was rejected. Tilak's friend, Wakil Daji Abaji Khare, left for London by ship, and Solicitor Kanga followed on 16th of October 1897. Barrister Deshpande and Advocate Setlur had prepared all the documents required for filing an appeal to the Privy Council. On 19th November 1897, the matter was heard by a bench of Lord Chancellor Aylesbury, Lord Hobhouse, Lord Davy and Sir Richard Couch. As far as Tilak was concerned, he was represented by Barrister Asquith, Umesh Chandra Banerjee, Barrister Pew and Wakil Khare. Bombay government was represented by Barristers Cohen and Strangsman. Asquith pointed out that the translations of some of the key words was harsh and inappropriate and explained the difference between criticism and sedition. He argued that it was the best opportunity for the apex court to admit the appeal and lay down the correct interpretation of section 124A of the Indian Penal Code, and the same would become a precedent for all the future cases. However, Privy Council held that unless it is shown that appropriate legal course was not adopted, or principles of natural justice were violated, or there was extreme miscarriage of justice, the Privy Council would not interfere in the criminal matters, and accordingly, the appeal was dismissed. Tilak was taken to the jail. He was kept in at Dongri Jail initially, subsequently shifted to House of Correction at Baikala. However, his health started deteriorating as the food in the jail was not palatable for Tilak, and he had to be shifted to Yerwada Jail at Pune. Advocate Setlur wrote to a Howard Society that something serious may go wrong with Tilak's health. Chafekar brothers, who were awaiting execution for the murder of Rand and Eyston, were also in Yerwada Jail. They met Tilak in the Yerwada Jail, who drafted a mercy petition on their behalf. However, Chafekar brothers were ultimately hanged. A lot of scholars were quite aghast with the kind of punishment that was given to Tilak. German scholar Max Müller said that he would support any step taken for release of Tilak. An application was made for Tilak's release, which was signed by Professor Max Müller, Sir William Hunter, Sir Richard Garth, William Kane, Ramesh Chandra, and Dadabhai Navroji, among other elites. Finally, on 6 September 1898, after remaining in jail for 51 weeks, Tilak was released. While releasing, the government itself imposed a condition that if Tilak continued with such activities in future and was again charged for sedition, this 6 months which was exempted would be added to the sentence on the next occasion. Government was keeping a close watch on Tilak's writings and speeches, among other Marathi newspapers and speeches. Since the release of Tilak, the popularity of Kesari, among other newspapers, soared, and government was aware of the same. Tilak's article of 12th May and 9 June issued in the issues of Kesari were found by government to fall within the definition of sedition. Before filing the case for sedition, it was mandatory to obtain permission of the Secretary of State for India, who at that time was Lord Morley. When the permission was sought, he was disinclined to file a case of sedition against Tilak. However, Governor Sir George Sydenham Clark, Governor of Bombay, felt that Tilak's prominence among the natives was increasing and his revolutionary activities needed to be stopped. He told Lord Morley that he was aware that Tilak's popularity will increase if the government failed to convict him, but he was willing to take the risk. Governor further informed that he has obtained a very favorable legal opinion. Ultimately, Lord Morley reluctantly granted permission. So the case of sedition was filed under Section 124A on 23rd June 1908 for writing articles, in fact, in both, two articles. Tilak at that time was staying at Sardar Guha, 5 minutes walking distance from the office of the police commissioner. However, the warrant was executed late in the evening to deny Tilak an opportunity to apply for the bail on the same day. There was a second warrant which was also issued to enable the police to confiscate all the papers and files, etc., at Tilak's residence in Pune office. And on 24 June 1908, inspection of the residence and office at Sihagad Road was carried out, and some incriminatory documents, such as list of books on bombs making, were confiscated. Government felt that the evidence, this evidence of these books, etc., will go against Tilak, as Tilak's editorial on 9 June had vivid mention of bomb making and explosive material. On 25th of June 1908, bail application was made by Barrister Dawar Jr. This is a different Dawar than the earlier one who appeared before the Presidency Magistrate Austin at Esplanade Police Court under Section 124A and 153A of the Indian Penal Code. The said application was immediately rejected. Again, the case being within the jurisdiction of the High Court, the case was committed to High Court sessions. The application was bail for me was moved by Barrister Muhammad Ali Jinnah on 2nd July 1908, which was again rejected by Justice Dawar. Now let us understand that Justice Dawar was the same advocate in the 1897 sedition trial. Now by 1908, he was already elevated on the bench of the Bombay High Court. And unfortunately, the second sedition trial came up for hearing before him. However, Justice Dawar did not recuse himself, nor Tilak made any raise any objection for his continuing to hear the case in spite of his past, in the past being a lawyer for himself. Barrister Baptista submitted there was no need for a special jury objecting to the application made by the government on 3rd July 1908. He said that even an ordinary jury was good enough. And the only thing that he said was required was that the persons who will act as jury must be in a position to read and understand Marathi. The British jury, according to him, would be biased and prejudiced. However, the court held that since the two articles have been officially translated by the translator, Oriental translator, there was no need to have juries who only understand Marathi. Accordingly, their objection was rejected. Before the trial started, an effort was made to find out a good Indian barrister who would represent Tilak. Surprisingly, not a single Indian barrister came forward to defend Tilak. It was presumed that barristers and wakil were afraid of going into the bad books of the government for defending an accused in a sedition case, since the lawyer would appear to be sympathetic towards the cause of the accused. Other reason could be that barrister would have to accept very nominal fee, which was also a deterrent. There was no question of asking any British barrister to appear because they would not. Getting barrister from outside, like it was done in 1897, would mean a lot of expenses, which was beyond the means Tilak means. Now, Tilak himself, being a law graduate, eventually decided that he will appear in person and conduct the trial. The trial started with examination of prosecution witness. Tilak argued the matter for 8 days, mainly on the following points. A, English translations of the Marathi articles were not proper because the words which were understood in Marathi, when they are literally translated, may not be have the same meaning as a person knowing Marathi would understand it. Merely because a list of books on making of bombs was found in Tilak's office table drawer did not mean that he encouraged making of bombs. He cited quite a few cases where people have in England have found against whom such material was found, and without any cogent evidence, no action was taken. Criticizing the government did not mean that the readers were being instigated to indulge in violence or manufacture of bombs. So these were the 3 points which he illustrated. He gave examples and cited cases not only from India, but also from England to buttress his points. Advocate General Branson, appearing with barrister in Variety, argued that the articles fell within the definition of sedition and there was no external proof required. He also submitted that Tilak has not put any person into the witness box to show that if the translations of certain words were not proper, what would be the correct meaning of that word? And merely because Tilak said that a particular meaning is attributed to that word does not mean the same. He, in a professional manner, dealt with all the points raised by Tilak. The jury consisted of 7 Europeans and 2 Parsis. The hearing was concluded at 8 p.m. on 2nd July 1908, and the jury went into consultation. When they came out, the verdict was 7 guilty and 2 not guilty. That is, 7 Europeans held guilty and 2 Parsis did not hold him guilty. On the basis of the verdict of the jury, Justice Dawar held Tilak guilty of sedition, and while quantifying the sentence, he said that he could give sentence of deportation for life. However, looking at his age and other factors, he was sentencing him to 6 years deportation and 1,000 rupees fine. Before declaring the sentence, he asked Tilak whether he wanted to say anything further. And what Tilak has said is now on a marble plaque, which is outside courtroom number, central courtroom. It says, in spite of the verdict of the jury, I maintain that I am innocent. There are higher powers that rule the destiny of men and nations, and it may be the will of the providence that the cause which I represent may prosper more by my suffering than by my remaining free. So that's how the sentence was given. The effect of the sentence was that Next day, strike was announced by the mill workers who refrained from going to work in protest. To break the strike, the government contacted mill owners to put pressure on the workers to end the strike. However, the mill owners were reluctant to take any steps against the workers. When some mill workers attempted to start work, there was stone throwing and rioting by the workers. When the mill owners, attempted to start. The police opened fire and arrested the rioters and prosecuted them and were sentenced up to 1 year hard labor. So the illustration that you see is the rioting outside the Esplanade Police Court, where the police is on the horse and the people who are pelting stones are dealt with heavy hand. On the day of the verdict, crowds started assembling at the entrance of the High Court. After order of conviction was passed, Tilak was taken in a van from Ovalside entrance of the High Court while the crowds waited at Flora Fountain side entrance to have a last glimpse of Tilak. Tilak was straightaway taken to Kulaba station of the BBNCI railway and there was a special train which was waiting for him to transport him out of Mumbai. He was taken by train to Ahmedabad and then to Sabarmati jail. On 10th of September 1908, he was brought to Bombay and was put on the ship Hardinge and was taken to Rangoon and then by train to Mandale and to the prison there. You can see the picture below, which is a picture of the Mandale prison. An appeal was filed on 7th of August 1908 against the judgment of Justice Dower, which was dismissed by the division bench of Justice Scott and Batchelor, except that the fine of 1,000 rupees was exempted, but the sentence was confirmed. Tilak's friend, Khapalde, who was all along with him and attending to the court, etc., proceeded by ship to London for taking steps for filing appeal before the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council. Now, Judicial Committee came under the Judicial Committee Act of 1833. Initially, the Privy Council, which consisted of law lords, was part of the House of Lords, and it sat as Privy Council whenever it heard appeals from the colonies. But the work started becoming heavy and they wanted a committee to go into that work so that it can advise the monarch about the outcome of the appeal. So Khapalde went to London to do exactly that. The appeal was filed. It came up before the Privy Council consisting of Lord Chancellor and Lord Halsbury in April 1909. It appeared that in both the matters before the Privy Council, the fate was already sealed because these were criminal matters. And as per the past record of the Privy Council, it hardly interfered in any criminal matter unless those three conditions were satisfied. A further application in the nature of a mercy petition, was filed on behalf of Tilak for reduction or annulment of the sentence before King Edward VII, who rejected the same. At the end of the six-year sentence, Tilak was brought to Madras from Mandale and Rangoon by a ship called Mayo. From Madras, Tilak was brought to his hometown Pune by Madras-Pune mail and then to his residence in February 1914. In conclusion, I would say that a fair trial was never given to Tilak. In both the trials, jury were packed with majority of British citizens who appeared to be biased and or unable to understand the nuances of Marathi language. Justice Dower, who had represented Tilak in 1897 trial, sat as a judge in 1908 trial and was so prejudiced that he gave stiff punishment of 6 months of deportation. Justice Strachey, who had decided the first trial, sat in a full bench to hear appeal against his own judgment. So he was one of the three judges against his own judgment. Tilak did not get the benefit of a competent barrister in 1908 trial, probably because of the government pressure. Although Tilak's editorials in both the cases did not result in any law and order situation, he was saddled with charge of sedition as law was interpreted by the British jury and the judges to suppress the right of freedom of speech to criticize the government. I may refer to the little bibliography and images that I procured. The main book which I referred for all this historical data is a book like a biography of Tilak by Narasiya Chintamani Kelkar in Marathi. Then the images came from Old and New Bombay. The other data came from Bombay Law Journal. Then further images came from Representative Men of Bombay Presidency, also the centenary publication of Bombay High Court, Google search, and personal collection. This is the stamp that you see was released by the government at the time of birth anniversary of Lokmanya Tilak.
So one participant is asking that the second trial, was it for both the articles?
Articles each, in both the trials.
Sir, do you have any published books on legal history?
I have not published any book, but there are quite a few books which are there on legal history. As students, I suppose most of you must have read the books that are available on legal history. My book is going to be a coffee table book. It will, of course, give a portion of legal history, but only restricted to Bombay.
Is the sedition law followed in India today, taken from the law used against Tilak?
Followed in the sense that the sedition as a section is still there on the law books. In fact, the matter is now pending before the Supreme Court, which is going to constitute a larger bench to ultimately give meaning to the word sedition, because it appears that the word is very loosely coined and there are a lot of sedition cases which are happening all over the country. So to give it a proper interpretation so that it is followed all over India, therefore the matter is pending before the Supreme Court.
As you say, the judge who sat in appeal was a trial judge, that is D.D. Dhawan. Was it legally possible at that time?
Legally possible in the sense it will be, such a thing would not have happened today, I can tell you that. The judge will himself recuse at that time. But no such application or objection was raised by Tilak. So therefore, probably Tilak thought that he was his counsel, so we'll understand. Because he very vehemently he argued the case in 1897 for his release. And the grounds or the facts were almost the same, because both were dealing with the articles and editorials written against the British government. But it happened the other way around. When Justice Dhawan went onto the bench, his view started looking for the British judge.
Sir, in your opinion, what does the word sedition mean?
See, I have no opinion, because I am not a criminal lawyer. And secondly, the word sedition has been defined in the Indian Penal Code. So if you go through that, probably you can judge for yourself what could be the meaning. Now, what is the boundary of sedition? That is what the court will decide. The Supreme Court will decide. Otherwise, any material which is seditious is sedition.
Would it be correct to say that it was very difficult for an Indian to get justice during the British era, particularly against the government?
I will not make a sweeping statement, because particularly in, not only in criminal, but in civil matters also, Supreme Court has repeatedly said about the decisions given by the Privy Council, I'm talking of the Apex Court, decisions given by the Privy Council are even valid today. Maybe for as far as the law of sedition is concerned, It may be the British judges were swayed and they gave a very sort of a tight interpretation, ultimately leading to certain arrests and whatever the sentences were given to them, like the Tilak's matters. Or maybe the Indian judge would have decided other way around. Take the British judge, Strachey, did not give Justice Badruddin Tayabji in the first case, immediately granted bail. But subsequently, the bail was rejected, even by Dhawan, Justice Dhawan. So it depends on ultimately the mental setup of the judge. See the juries. In both the trials, the British juries were as a lot and they were in majority. As far as Indian juries were concerned, like Parsis and Jews, etc., they gave a completely different verdict. So all of them were hearing the same matter at the same place, but they saw it in a different light. And if the special jury was not appointed and only juries of Indian background were appointed, they would have probably said that there was no sedition.
At the beginning of the session, you briefly mentioned that there were three trials conducted against Tilak. Can you briefly talk about the third trial?
Third trial against for sedition was there, but it was distinguished because it was not directed against the government. It was considered that it was directed against the mismanagement by the bureaucracy. So therefore, the court felt that there was no sedition because against the government as such, and he was acquitted. So I thought that did not raise any interesting questions, so I did not include this. And these two trials were interconnected because of so many things, like advocate becoming a judge, and the sentence was of 6 months, which was given the benefit, was added to the other sentence, etc.
Who was the AOR when Jinnah was appearing?
if it is advocate on record, then Bhai Shankar Kangave, the solicitors were all along appearing in the trial as advocate on record.
So one participant is asking that, you know, in history, the courts, you know, the judges were British. So there was a lot of bias involved, right?
Yeah, as far as matters of this nature was concerned. Otherwise, there was no bias because in particular in civil matters, etc., there was no bias involved. In any case, judges are also human beings. It's not that the British judges were completely foolproof and would not make mistakes. They were appeal court, they were apex court, which were there to correct those mistakes. So I will not pass a direct statement that they were biased against the Indians or something. Maybe in a sedition case, they saw the whole thing in a different concept. So they found it, whatever was written was seditious. They did not appreciate, probably, that the right to criticize the government, because there was no fundamental right at that time. So right to criticize the government was right of freedom of speech, which after 1950, the right has been ingrained in the constitution. So such situation will never come unless, as I said, that there is a very thin line between sedition and non-sedition. And whether a person has gone over the line or not, that is for the judge to decide.
So one participant is asking, are there any other interesting sedition cases during the British era?
Yeah, there were quite a few. Mahatma Gandhi's case also. Tilak was writing in Kesari. Mahatma Gandhi was writing in Young India. But the difference was that when Mahatma Gandhi was sought to be punished, he made the task very simple. He told the court, I plead guilty. So the court gave him a sentence which was mild because anyway he was a very senior person. So gave a mild sentence. He said, the court said, you have saved our time. There's nothing to decide. You have pleaded guilty. So now we'll decide. And gave him whatever this was. So there were so many sedition cases, not only here in Calcutta, all the time they were happening. But Tilak case was something where he was sent on deportation. And Tilak was a very big leader at that point of time. Mahatma Gandhi had just arrived on the scene, but he was still not the leader of what he was subsequently. So Tilak had to bear the brunt because of his popularity, not only as a journalist, but as a speaker who could actually convince the crowd of what he's speaking.
And so one participant is asking, why was he sent to Burma?
Deportation means it has to be in a secluded place. Now, one place was Andaman, where Mr. Savarkar was sent. Other place was Burma, because Burma, till 1937, was part of British India. So taking to Burma was not taking to another country. And there was a prison in Mandalay, like all other prisons that were all over India. So deportation to a place which is secluded, because there was a special arrangement for there to be put in seclusion in a particular cell. And the sentence was for hard labor also. So that was felt convenient. It was for the government to decide. So deportation was actually not deportation to a foreign country, but deportation to a place of the choice of the government. Government could have kept him in Yerwada also, but that would have mean, because when you are put in a jail, there are certain rules by which you are allowed to have guests, you can meet people. Suppose your case is pending while you are in jail, you are allowed to meet your lawyers. So it would be difficult for any lawyer, while the case was pending, for that lawyer in those days to go to Burma and take instructions, come back, file, etc. So the government thought that to seclude him completely from the main Indian continent was the right thing for them to do.
So one participant wants to know if you can suggest a library in Mumbai where he can find books on legal history.
Library in Mumbai. First thing is that if the person who is asking is a lawyer, he can find those books maybe in the High Court library. There are books which he as a student must have read. Those books are good enough. And if you want to do some serious study leading to a master's degree or a doctoral thing, then of course you'll have to search for libraries abroad, which are now you can online, and you can find those books.
So one participant wants to know that what was the highest term for punishment in cases of sedition during the British regime?
Highest was deportation for life. Not only hard labor for life, but deportation. Hard labor and deportation for life. That's what Justice Dhawan said. I could have given you that sentence, but looking at your age and other circumstances means it would have created a riot. So he wanted to balance it by giving a sentence where the people will not be that agitated, but at the same time, Tilak is kept out of the scene for number of years. So he gave 6 years. If he was to give a life imprisonment sentence, I think I don't know what would have happened to the Indian politics at that time.
Sir, there is one question. I'm tweaking it a little. Sir, the participant is talking about the movies, you know, how these trials are showcased. He's talking about Gandhiji's trial showcased in the movie. So, sir, can you comment on how, like, are these trials fairly showcased in movies or it's different?
No, the thing is that I am not aware of any Gandhiji's trial. I'm not talking of Gandhiji's life or the picture Gandhi by I'm talking of Gandhiji's trial. I don't know of any film which shows actual Gandhiji's trial. Gandhiji's trial means the murder trial, the Godse's trial. Gandhiji was not on trial. You are talking of Gandhiji's murder case or Gandhiji's trial, which is only of a very limited duration, because every time he was arrested, he pleaded guilty. So there was hardly anything to show as a trial. If you are talking about Gandhiji's murder trial, I am not aware of any film which is showing that exact trial as I know. As far as Tilak is concerned, there was a film, Marathi film. Unfortunately, I found that since it was on the life of Tilak, it did not show the trial in the way it should have been done. Actually, there was no court scene, because I had seen that movie and they only find that after he is punished, he is taken away from the High Court and put into the train, etc. But a deep study and showing the actually what happened in the court cases which happened in Bombay has not been shown at all anyway.
Sir, one participant wants to know that were these sedition trials only against individuals or there were trials in the history against a group or class of people also?
A group in the sense, of course, here also the sedition trial was not only Tilak, but I did not touch upon that subject because the trial was against the press, against the press in which this paper was published, against the owner of the place. There are so many people who were involved in this, but I only restricted myself to Tilak. I casually mentioned about two people who were involved, and their trials took place separately.
Sir, any closing remarks on Lokmanya Tilak? Any message that you want to give to the advocates and the enthusiasts who have joined today?
See, I am an old timer. Although I practice, my most of the time is spent on doing research on legal history. So, if the people only feel that they have time to only make money and not bother about the legal history, well, they are free to do so. They are young. They have to set up their practice, etc. But if somebody wants to do any serious research, there are a lot of topics which are available where they can do a research. While doing my book on Legal Bombay, I can just tell you my experience that there have been, in the last about 10 years, at least 5 to 6 very good books are already published on different aspects of Bombay High Court, etc. So I asked myself a question, is one more book required on this topic? I found that as far as the legal history of Bombay, which almost goes, basically the period is 1296 to 1947. So you'll wonder what was happening in 1296. Well, there was a court. Therefore, I decided that on this topic, nobody has touched upon. Secondly, nobody has come out with a coffee table book on this topic. There is a coffee table book published by the High Court on the building, High Court building, centenary, etc. But there has not been any coffee table book on this, the subject which I am touching and which the people will find it interesting. For example, as me, it was mentioned that I am a collector of stamps. Yes, I do collect not the postage stamps, but I do collect court fee stamps and stamp papers. And my period starts from 1800 to 1947. Now, there are solicitors who have been dealing with documents while they're examining titles. They must have handled a lot of title documents which are on parchment paper. The stamps which started with East India Company, then Victoria, Edward VII, George V, George VI. But how many people have preserved them? And how many people who are in practice would like to see that old archival material? That is the main bedrock of my book, to show something which is not easily available and which the people may have forgotten, or people are not aware that such a thing exists. So if somebody wants to do any serious research, etc., there are many topics available. And as juniors, while you practice, you work hard, but at the same time, leave some little time for going back into the history and you will enjoy it.
Thank you so much, sir. Generations to come will cherish your work.
Thank you.